So my name is Chance Bruchet. I graduated from Bishop Kenny in 2016, and I currently go to FSU. The co-organizers of this town hall are Alejandro Hernandez, Ariel Navotis, Nick Johnson, Ivana Peso, and Valera Hernandez. So recently, the Black Lives Matter movement, as you all know, is the biggest civil rights movement in pretty much the history of the world. It spread to all 50 states and 17 countries. And due to the Black Lives Matter movement, people are more open to sharing their experiences with racism, prejudice, and discrimination. And this includes the Bishop Kenny community. There's been an uptake in posts by Black students and alumni detailing their experiences with racism and prejudice and discrimination of all types, including Instagram page Black at BK, which I'm sure most of you guys are aware of. And while we don't condone the methods they use, we do support the message. It's disheartening that Black, POC, and LGBTQIA+ members of the Bishop Kenny community felt as though they couldn't express their experiences while being there. So the first part of this town hall will allow students from various marginalized communities to give their testimonies. This discussion and this conversation is open to everyone from all types of marginalized communities, including the Black community, Latinx community, the disabled community, and the queer community. Part two of the town hall will be a discussion. We received over 6 responses to the pre-town hall survey. Many students gave excellent recommendations on things that Bishop Kenny can do to improve diversity and inclusion. So we'll be reading some of these recommendations, and then we will open the discussion up to you guys so you guys can talk about what you believe Bishop Kenny could do in the future in order to promote diversity and inclusion.
So clearly you can see I am not a person of color, but I am a member of the LGBT community, and I would like to try to relate my experiences with Bishop Kenny to this because of the potential lack of testimonies, but I still want to bring light to any type of discrimination a person may face. And so I ended up having a very rough time my freshman and sophomore year at Bishop Kenny before I ended up making my really solid group of friends. I remember coming to Bishop Kenny super excited with the people from my middle school that I knew. And any new person I met, one of the first questions that came out of their mouth was I gay? And then it would be normally followed up with, because if you are, I can't be your friend. And this was also at a time for myself where I didn't know I was gay. Like, granted, my voice probably gave it away, but I didn't do any self-discovery of that way. And it was kind of taken away from me. And that really hurt that, I mean, I felt like I was a pretty solid person. I thought it'd be fun to meet new people, and being judged by something I didn't even know about myself at the time was hurtful. And so it progressed to even worse situations when I was in the locker room at Kenny, where a lot of the guys in my class would end up pinning me down or moving me around in the locker room when I was showering because it made me uncomfortable and I had no reason to. And they'd always be basically trying to see if I was going to pop a boner or something like that, so they could be like, oh my gosh, he is gay. Everyone stay away from him. So every time I had gym class, I was mortified to go, and I'd always try to get in, get out, because I didn't want to deal with it. And one of the final straws I ended up having that kind of like drove me deep into the closet. And I was like, there's no way I'm going to tell anyone until I leave Bishop Kenny. And that's because one day I went to my locker and someone had cared so much. Granted, this freshman year, first semester, someone had cared so much about me. I didn't even know them, that they talked to one of my friends, figured out my locker combo, broke in and drew a penis and wrote faggot in Sharpie on my locker door. And that was something I had to stare at every single day until the end of freshman year, and I couldn't get rid of it. And I ended up learning who did it, someone I had no like acquaintanceship with whatsoever. I had no understanding as to why, and there was nothing I could do. Because what, I'm going to go to a teacher and be like, I heard that some kid did this to me, but I don't have proof who did it, but now it's written in my locker and it's not going to come off. There's going to be no help from me. And I was already told by a couple of teachers at Bishop Kenny that, you know, being gay is a sin, so I didn't even want to go down that road. And I just felt like I couldn't talk to anyone. I told my parents and they felt the exact same way. My dad's response was go up to the kid and punch him in the face. To this day, I'm glad I didn't. He does not deserve that. But there was nothing I could have done. I couldn't go to a teacher. I couldn't go to the guidance counselors. I could tell them like it hurt my feelings, but there is nothing they could do, nothing that kid was ever going to learn from it. But that stuck with me to this day. And I just wish that, you know, I don't want other kids to go through it. Granted, I got very lucky. I went off to college and I met a solid group of friends, and I've been able to come out and learn more about myself, which is a huge joy when it comes to college. But it shouldn't only be in college that that occurs. Kids should have the earliest opportunity to do that with their friends that they're making. And that's kind of why I wanted to share this. And that's the thing. I was judged on something that no one could even see. I couldn't even begin to imagine people who are just getting completely marginalized stereotyped by their skin. Granted, you can maybe hear it in my voice, but it was something that really helped me to empathize with the Black community, because discrimination on any end is unjustified and horrid, and it has long effects. And I would very much like it if we get people in here to learn, listen, and grow after this. And I think that's all I really want to say.
I've been reading some of the postings on the Black FBK page, and 20 years later, I am more than appalled at what I'm reading. I'm truly appalled at what I'm seeing developing at that institution, because I don't want to say we were the first large scale minority class there at Bishop Kenny, but we had, there were a lot of us there, and things were not that bad. Things were, yes, it was a difficult school. Academically, it was difficult. And I can only imagine how much more difficult it's gotten now. But I mean, yes, there were problems, but they were handled when they were brought to light. It wasn't really this whole thing of being afraid or being deterred from stepping out and pointing out issues was not prevalent. It was, I guess, Father Hooley has retired. I know Miss Marnette passed away. So, I mean, I know there's probably new staff there, but I mean, I'm going to be blunt, you know, my class, you know, the people that were involved at that level, at that point in time, in that graduating class, you know, there was like, I think five or six of us that graduated in 2002. And we encountered stupidity. We had issues, but it wasn't as bad as I'm reading. But we just felt that the only way to address that was to excel academically, and that would mitigate the problems that would hopefully mitigate a lot of the problems that we were seeing. And we thought that naively. And I'll be blunt with you guys, we failed you. To everyone on this chat who came after we did, after 2002, we failed you, because we didn't take it seriously, we just didn't take it head on, because we were in high school and we were struggling to keep our heads afloat. It was a completely different environment for a lot of us. So yeah, we didn't focus on the right thing, I guess, as you could say, but we just, I am truly sorry. We did not do right by you guys, and you guys are paying the price for this now. You know, I'm looking at people who appear to be at least several decades younger than me. I mean, and I'm just saddened by what you're having to experience going to school there. That should not be a hallmark of one of the, I mean, at the time, it was one of the pristine crown jewels of the Diocese of St. Augustine. I mean, I'm not Catholic. Protestant by choice and by upbringing. So I mean, yeah, there was also that to contend with. And yeah, it was a little weird going to mass and you guys saying the rosary and everything else. Where some of us are sitting there and it was like, yeah, we're just gonna hang on here for a second. Sorry about that. But it just, I mean, seriously, how did things get this bad? I don't, I mean, there were things in place that were being done by the time my graduating class, by the time my class graduated, and it was designed to increase the amount of recruitment that was being done for diversity. Okay, fine. Because Father Rooley was adamant about going and reaching out to schools like St. Pius, Holy Rosary, and I think St. Patrick's on the north side. I'm not sure. I think it's either St. Patrick's or St. Matthew's, one of those two. But there was an actual real concerted effort to do this. And I don't see any of that in any of these statements that are being, that I'm reading on the Instagram page. I see a lot of things that are being tolerated that shouldn't be and shouldn't even be allowed. Has the disciplinary structure at the school just collapsed entirely? I mean, maybe one of the hosts can answer that question. What is going on?
If I can interject to kind of give my understanding of the potential answer, to me, it seems like the reason that things have gotten so bad is that teachers, faculty, staff, and guidance counselors, they all want proof. And all of these are verbal altercations, so it's one person's word against another. Anyone would like to chime in and give their kind of input on that. That's been kind of my understanding. That's how I took everything. I had no physical proof. It's my word against someone else's.
Okay, so in regards to like the disciplinary like aspects of Kenny, I would say that on the surface front, it's like well-intentioned, but it doesn't go in depth enough for it to even cater to that of like racial issues, because I think in some ways the racism and the bias and the discrimination has just like in the institution itself has just become normalized. And due to its like normality, there's a lot of things people would say. And I think I overheard somebody say, I don't know if it was like one of the anonymous posts that Chance was reading, but somebody said like, there will be teachers around and people will say certain things like this, but everyone laughs in the classroom too. So then you yourself just decide, okay, well, it's kind of hard to bring attention to something people find comical. And it's even that more agitating to put yourself in the position. I mean, for instance, for me, some of the classes I was in, I was the only like Black person in some of those classes. And it was actually a bit difficult to try to come and understand how or why I had to address certain things or how I should address something. And all of that just becomes a bit overwhelming, especially if it's something you're doing yourself in an institution that's not helping you. It becomes very overwhelming. And I would say that that's probably the reason why this needs to be looked at a bit more seriously, because mentally and physically, I was going through something where a lot of the students did not have to deal with. And I could say the same thing with a lot of people that look like me. But again, I say that I don't think it was taken seriously because it was kind of played off as child's play or joking around or, just high schoolers being idiots when no, like it was just blatant racism.
When I was a sophomore at Bishop Kenny, there was a meme made of me. Someone found a picture of me from Facebook and called it Excited Black Girl. The comments on it said things like, wow, I love watermelon. And when you turn the lights off, you can't see me. They also said very hurtful things about my weight. It hurt me because I knew it had to be someone who had access to my Facebook page, which means it was a friend. I eventually found out who started it, and it was someone I had known since middle school. I was also always told I was an Oreo or that I act white because of the way I spoke and my taste in music.
Okay, so my testimony was the anonymous one about the meme. And just to go further into that, when I had found out about it, before even going to anyone, I automatically went to the person I knew that had taken the picture. And instead of trying to help me figure out how it could have happened, she just laughed at it. And it didn't surprise me because this is also a person from Bishop Kenny that I would go to her house and her grandmother would say, oh, your colored friend is here. And she would laugh about that. And when I would leave, she would call me and tell me, oh, my grandma said you're my N-word friend and didn't try to check her, wouldn't do anything about that. So it was like, okay, yeah, I'm your friend, but then when it comes down to it, my race is a joke to you. So because I speak well and I like different like pop music, I am just white enough for you. It just felt like as long as I didn't show any of my blackness, it was okay for people. And it just doesn't seem right to erase somebody's blackness just because of the way they speak. And that's just my personal experience with it and everything, really.
Yeah, well, first of all, I'd like to thank you guys for giving me the opportunity to attend this event and everybody else for coming in and joining. I remember from when I went to school at Bishop Kenny, this wasn't necessarily something that happened to me, but looking back on it now with a different perspective, I do see how it was wrong. And what I'm referring to was another student on it now as someone who is also an atheist who isn't religious. I do see it as alarming because, you know, like whether we choose to believe something or not, like we all have freedom of religion, and I don't think that that should be a reason to gossip about anybody. I think that, you know, if the school wants to teach, hey, like this is the faith that we believe in, I'm okay with that. But I think that the line that you have to draw is, you know, you shouldn't encourage hostility towards somebody of a different belief system.
Hi. So I would kind of echo what Michael was saying, but also want to highlight that like these issues that have happened at Bishop Kenny have been incredibly rampant, and the perspective that I've gotten over the past several years after leaving have been like completely life-changing. And I think I like with what B is saying, we all failed as alumni, not we all failed, but we could have done more if, as a white person seeing these experiences going on, but not having the wherewithal to understand what was going on. But an experience that I had in a religion class actually, where a teacher told a student that only Catholics go to heaven and everyone else is going to hell. And then a student who was Protestant raised her hand and said, including me, and she said yes. And things like that are like, Bishop Kenny has this sort of thing that I experienced, and hopefully, I mean, obviously it hasn't changed, but anyone who's not white or straight or Catholic is the other, and it's toxic. So I really would love to see some positive change that impacts everyone and creates a better society there. So.
Yeah, so basically, I guess, in regards of Kenny altogether, I think it kind of goes back to just what someone had previously said in regards of if you're not Catholic or white, you're the other. And I say or white simply because there is a white majority at a school. It's understandable. But I think because of that, the majority rules, it's become like a reason to sort of ignore a lot of the issues that are going on because it's not affecting the majority of the students there. So if it's not affecting the majority of the students there, then it's just non-existent. And due to the, like for me, personal experience, I've had issues with just like high school crushes. There was this one guy who I was talking to at the time, and we just ended up stopped talking because he was starting to get bullied by his friends as to why he was talking to me. And to me, something like that is rather bizarre because people should not have to be getting hit in the locker room. And I felt guilty for that because it was after we graduated, which he filled me in, where he said like his friends were just like playfully throwing punches at him in the locker room just because he happened to be talking to me. So basically, I guess from there, what I would just say is like a lot of it is the fact that it's not something that affects the majority. It's a minority issue, so it's not looked at as seriously, and it's not it's not direct offense or hostility towards the faculty or staff. I think even as high schoolers, yes, we can be really ignorant, but it's no excuse to, like, we can't put it all on their shoulders because they're grown and they know better. But at the same time, I think a lot of it does have to do with, because it does not affect the majority of the students there, it's not necessarily seen as a real issue. And because it's also not a real issue, a lot of like the serious things that happen get turned into jokes or get thrown under the bus, or, oh no, you know, they're just messing around. I've been called the N-word quite a few times, and one of the anonymous posts said it, like, similar things to me, the person just got a really, you know, rough talk, like, you shouldn't say stuff like that. Or being called the N, being around someone who uses the N-word, but then being told that I shouldn't really be offended by it because I'm an Oreo person. And this goes into the danger that Melanie was talking about in regards of erasing somebody's blackness. It's like, oh, like, I can call everyone else who is black the N-word, but you're not the N-word because you're just enough white for me, essentially, is what, like, is uttered. And a lot of these things, they don't seem serious, but mentally, the mental health of people that have to endure it, it's hard. Like, you can't necessarily strive. The point of Bishop Kenny is to give that academic challenge and balance to that of someone to push out the best in them. But when you're in the institution where you're like from 7 a.m. to 3 p.m. every single day, and if you do like sports, God forbid, you feel like the bottom feeder, like you're not going to get to that point. I personally, like, suicide had been something that I had, like, God, with God's blessing, none of them have ever, you know, like, sold out. That's why I'm, like, here right now. But a lot of attempts, but then I still have to go to school the next day smiling. But you can't tell anybody these problems, because when you do bring up race or talk about race, it becomes a really taboo topic. And we'll start mimicking and talking about it for a little bit, and then somebody says something funny and it's up in the air. So I think that was a long explanation, but at the end of the day, it's just because it's not taken seriously because it's not being affected by the majority. Not everybody there is atheist, not everybody there is Muslim, not everybody there is Catholic. Like, a majority of the people are white and Catholic. I myself am Catholic, but I'm not white. So.
Like, how is all of this racism happening? I think something for me that I've noticed is, like, everyone's talking about, like, wow, like, racism has been increasing in schools and all these large institutions. And in reality, I think it's just more of, like, well, it's just becoming transparent. And I think racism has always been there all along. And it really just depends on the perspective that you have. Because if you asked me, I graduated in 2013. And if you asked me around that time, like, oh, like, do you feel like you've experienced racism? I would probably say no. Like, I've had a good time at Bishop Kenny, but now 7 years later, I feel like I've come through this, like, consciousness of actually, like, reading everyone else's narratives on racism. I'm like, I experienced that as well. And yeah, I think, I don't know if that really helps the conversation, but I just wanted to add in there that, like, I think I'm just tired of people saying, like, racism is on the rise, and really, like, no, it's being filmed, it's being, I guess.
Yes, so I'm a more recent graduate of Bishop Kenny. I graduated in 2019, actually. So I would say along the same lines, I don't think it's changed at all. I feel like it's been like this, but like you said, it's just becoming more transparent, and I feel like it just becomes so normalized at Bishop Kenny because people make it as jokes, and you don't even realize that it's not funny until after you've left that environment and after you have gained perspective that that's actually racism and just how rampant it is in our society. And I think also, just especially with the Bishop Kenny community, it's a lot of, like, people will go there and then they'll send their kids there and they'll ingrain them with the same values. So it's just a lot of, like, the community hasn't really changed, and that needs to, and there needs to be more education among these kids so they don't put that into their kids. But so just as a more recent graduate, I feel like, I don't know if anything's changed. I think it's just becoming more transparent, and it is so normalized in that environment. And there needs to be more like education in the school, because there's not enough.
I was actually very hesitant on mentioning this, but the reason why I'm so alarmed about that now is because 2 years after I graduated from Bishop Kenny, so I'm class in 2016, but 2 years after I graduated from Bishop Kenny, I got tricked into joining a cult. And some of the things that happened during that time was basically the same thing like we would tell other people that they were going to hell. And what happened in my case when I left this group was the same thing basically happened to me. And as somebody who has done research on cultic groups and has actually been on the inside, like knows the process very well from that perspective, I really do see some signs that are very alarming, like the idea or the concept of black and white thinking, where you divide people into certain groups and like basically people drawing a circle around themselves and saying that we are special and everybody else is bad. And going back to the religion, or what Maria mentioned about saying that Catholic student or students who aren't Catholic were going to hell, I do see a similarity between that and what I've researched and what I've seen in this other group that I was involved in. And I think that that is something that the school can do much better with.
I feel like I want to talk about the like transphobia and homophobia that I kind of experienced being at Bishop Kenny. I graduated in 2015, and while I was at Kenny, I realized I was bi, and it took me a few years after I graduated to realize I was trans, just because I don't know, I didn't really have the resources to understand that. But some of the most distinct memories I have when I'm thinking about Bishop Kenny now are like when Caitlyn Jenner came out as trans my senior year when I was there. I remember our whole class during whatever class it was, including the teacher, kept making a lot of jokes about her where they were dead naming her and misgendering her and making the like man in a dress type comments. And at the time I didn't realize I was trans, but I was part of the community then, and it just made me very uncomfortable, and I felt like I couldn't speak out because I don't know, I just didn't feel comfortable or safe doing that. And I actually have a pretty hard time looking back at my time at Kenny, because like I just felt very isolated and alone. I guess I didn't really know if there were anyone else there like me, because no one talked about it really. We were taught in a class that homosexuality was a sin. I remember that being on a test. So I had like absolutely no one to talk to about it, and I fell into a really deep depression that I'm still kind of struggling with. It's better now because when I got to college, I was able to find a community there and people who understood. But I don't know, I just feel like there's something that the school could do to just be a little bit better for the queer students there, because I know Catholicism historically is pretty anti-LGBT, but we exist. Being race Catholic didn't stop me from turning out very gay and queer, and I just really want the school to do better.
I've been to private Catholic schools my whole life, and I'm basically used to being the token black kid at everything, basically. And I think it took me going to an HBCU. I went to Hampton University. So in case you don't know what HBCU, Historically Black College University, to realize all the microaggressions that I faced going there. I mean, my elementary and middle school experience was much worse. I say Blessed Trinity has a lot to work on, but in terms of Bishop Kenny, I realized how little things like touching a Black person's hair, like, don't do that. Or talking about watermelon and fried chicken, don't do that. Or I've even had people be comfortable saying the N-word around me. And sadly, I did not speak up at that time. And it took me a while too, because I just felt like I was not comfortable saying, like, hey, I'm not comfortable you saying that, being that I was like the only Black person around. But now I'm like, if you say it, we're gonna have some issues now. But then I wasn't as comfortable saying that. So I just feel like, I don't know, I feel like Bishop Kenny needs to incorporate a talk about microaggressions. I mean, even my school is doing that, or even just macroaggressions, like straight up, why are you saying that? But I kind of feel for the kids that I was with in my class who just didn't feel comfortable with speaking up at that point. And I just feel really sad about the girl I'm thinking about I was in high school until now. And I really wish I was comfortable enough to speak out about how that made me uncomfortable at that time. But thankfully I did have, most of the time I was surrounded by people that I was comfortable with, but it was the other people I wasn't. So yeah, just want to say that.
I was born and raised in Brooklyn, New York. So I had the experience of attending I went to a predominantly Black Catholic high school, middle school. So I had that experience. And then when I moved to Bishop Kenny, I had my world changed, because this was the first time I was interacting with so many white people. So I really did not know what to expect. So my initial experiences were, you know, people call me the N-word, you know, then they're asking me why I'm upset. They're kidding. They're not racist. For me, I've always had the, you know, blessed to be study and work hard. So I excelled in my classes, and they would call me different. You know, you're different. You know, you're not like everybody else. You're a different kind of Black person. And I remember going home in high school being so mad and so angry, and I just didn't know how to explain it. You know, my mom would say, hey, why are you mad? And I just said, I don't want to talk about it, because it was just so much pain. And I really didn't know what to say. And over time, I started realizing that, you know, people wanted to attribute my greatness to me not being Black. You know, whenever a Black person is doing something great, they want to take that away from us. They want to give it to something. They want to say, oh no, he's not Black, he's white. You know, they want to take it away from us. But for me, it only served as motivation. I remember this day specifically, and this is one of the moments that I always think back to, and it reminds me why I'm always working so hard. I remember I was sitting in anatomy class, and I was arguing with this kid, and he's saying a lot of racial slurs. And he pretty much says, you know, what is God trying to tell you? The bones in the body are white. What is God trying to tell you? Okay, so, I mean, these are the kinds of conversations they were having when I was in my class. So imagine someone telling you that. I started yelling in the middle of class, and I got very upset. And the teacher asked me what's going on. She clearly heard. And I'm like, he said something racist. And like everybody else, you know, he got a little stern talking to him. You know, that's not okay. No referral was written, and no provisions were taken. But it's fine, you know. I always tell myself, I will have the last laugh. You know, I'm working hard. You know, I'm in med school. I'm gonna do what I have to do, and I'm gonna show these kids what that I've been working hard, and no matter what they say, I'm gonna be great. So it doesn't matter. And to people of color, I'm gonna let you guys know this. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how hard we go, because they will always try to take away our greatness. They will always try. I see this in higher level institution. I am in med school, in higher level education, and I'm still dealing with these same microaggressions. You know, things haven't changed. On top of that, something to answer your question is, you know, I think it's funny. You're asking, and you are bringing a very valid point. You know, why hasn't things changed at Bishop Kenny? Well, you know, I asked Ariel, is this meeting only solely open to just alumni? No, she said it's open to faculty. Students. I mean, I think it's funny. I don't see any faculty here. You know, people want to release a statement. You know, everybody wants to release a statement. Everybody wants to be an ally. But when it's time to show up and, you know, do the work and show that you're show what you're really about, nobody wants to show up. So, you know, that those are things that are important. You know, where are the faculty who are interacting with the students of color? Where are they? They're not in this meeting right now, listening, adding their contributions, and, you know, taking this information. They're not here. You know, I guess they were busy doing something else. I don't know, but they're not here. We need people in the faculty need to be here. They need to sit here. They need to experience the pain that the students are talking about, because they're not here. They're enjoying their Sunday, and we're, you know, people of color, we're taking our time. You know, that's the thing that I find ironic. You know, where we have to take the time out of our day. We not only have to do with like studying, research, other important things like working, but we also have to deal with racism. Come on, like, I have a bunch of other things to do, but I also have to deal with racism, and I also have to, you know, fight for social justice. So, I mean, come on. I need more people to step up, and I need everybody to stop wanting to be an ally. I need, when you see somebody saying something offensive, I need you to step up. I need you in that moment. There are key moments in life that tell you the kind of person you are. When you see somebody being abused, I need you to say something. I need you to step up and say, that's not right. Why are you doing that? And to me, those are critical moments. So that's all I have to add. Thank you for listening.
But sort of going off what Nathan was saying, and I think you put it so eloquently and beautifully, I think there's definitely like a fault, like a definitely like bad part in regards to the faculty. And at least in my experience, what's it called? In my 4 years in Bishop Kenny, in regards to sort of teaching, because that's the whole role of what a professor or like a teacher should be. They should be, what's it called, teaching and sort of mentoring the youth, and so they can go into society and be like good men and women of Christ, since it's a Catholic institution. And in my entire time there, and I'll admit it, what's it called, I did have some insecurities about my ethnicity, especially being an immigrant. So as a sort of form to sort of protect myself, I definitely participated in sometimes in racist remarks, not necessarily towards what's it called the Black community, but it was more geared towards other Hispanics, more from like the Central American ethnicity. And honestly, that went up all the way up until my senior year. And it wasn't until my Spanish teacher, I'll give her a shout out because I think she was great, Senora Phillips, I think she's still there. I think she was the only person who stood up to me and sort of questioned me about like why I was, like why I had this belief, and sort of changed my mind, sort of converted me and showed me why my belief at the time was wrong. To me, while I'm fortunate that she did do that, because what's it called, it showed me that my belief at the time was racist and it was wrong, and I'm happy I don't think that way anymore, but I just find it unfortunate that only one faculty member out of, what's it called, I don't know, like 30, 40 people there are at Bishop Kenny. Because I remember in history classes, I'd see my peers make racist remarks towards others, and sort of the faculty would sort of like awkwardly laugh it off and just ignore it and continue on. So I just, like at now, thinking back, it's just absurd that out of all the faculty in those 4 years, only one teacher had sort of the willingness and like the morals to stand up for what was right.
Backing up what everyone said, and especially what Alex said, I think that's like a really good point in regards of us like giving the faculty like just the truth in regards of it being a Catholic establishment. The point of it is to make sure that we're raised in a way where we're able to bring other people to God, or we're raised in a way where we're able to shine light in that of what it is to be just a quote-unquote child of God. But while at the school, the only thing that happened was I questioned God in regards of, well, if these are the kind of people worshiping God, then I don't think God is exactly who they think he is. If I don't know if that made sense. So like the faculty also has to realize that without their contribution or without their like stern no to discrimination or racism in the school or in the establishment, it's going to stay the same, regardless if there's 5 or 50 diverse clubs that are made overnight, or every once in a while we talk about why you shouldn't be racist. Like it's not going to do anything until they also put that into like to be able to work those steps to actually come up about that. Because I think one good point that my younger sister attends the school, but she asked me, she was like, well, you know, like we're always talking about pro-life, but the minute you bring up racism, all of a sudden it's either a black or white issue, when in reality, racism is that of like just looking down on someone because they don't look like you. We don't talk about that enough. We talk about pro-life and we talk about why they're like abortion is bad, but we don't talk about why it's disrespectful to life to look down on somebody the way quote unquote God made them. And it's not enough to just say God made everyone in his image, because there's people who deliberately do not see that of someone who is their classmate, even next to them in regards of like status or level. So I think the faculty needs to really take into consideration that this is what's going to happen. And if we are supposed to be the future of the church is not really going to stand really strong if the people who are supposed to be building it up are just as weak-minded. So yeah, that's all I have to say.
Yeah, so there were a couple things that I actually thought of in terms of like the concept of religious discrimination. Like it's something that a lot of people don't really, kind of like with the issue of racism, that it's not really talked about a lot in Catholic school. And with religious discrimination, I don't really think that's talked about enough either. And one of the facts that I have to back that up is there's a Pew Research poll that basically surveyed people on like, would you vote for this person for president? And it turns out that 40% of Americans said that they would not vote for somebody just for being an atheist. Now, I find that alarming, because if we took that poll and it said that 40% of Americans wouldn't vote for somebody just for being black, then there would be outrage, and rightfully so. Or if we took that same poll and said that 40% of Americans wouldn't vote for somebody for being Jewish, then that would be a problem. So my point in mentioning that is that I think that discrimination against students who aren't religious might become more of a problem. And yeah, it's like I said, I think it's something that the school can do so much better with.
So first, I'm going to start by reading some of the anonymous testimonies provided to us through the survey. The first one is...
Thanks, Chance. I want to begin my statement with gratitude to an academic institution like BK that allows intergroup dialogue such as today's. It was not until I left the state recently that I fully grasped my current situation as an Asian American from a dominantly white and white-passing community. I am now critically conscious that I have been marginalized because of my heritage and skin color, and that sometimes it requires shaking the status quo to let others know that communities of color have been historically hurt and ignored. I now want to recount some of my experience at BK. Once during my sophomore year, several peers teased my then partner with jokes to the effect of, "I heard your girlfriend eats dogs." I laughed reflexively at the time because jokes at my culture's expense were so ubiquitous. I remember another event in my senior year wherein my peers discussed attendance at a nearby university. I commented on how I felt a lack of diversity upon touring the school earlier that year. One of my white peers who had committed there for undergraduate studies interjected with, "Why? It's because you think people like my family and me are racist." I swiftly apologized and worked to assuage her in response to the accusation, although in retrospect, I'm only sorry for my younger self in believing that academic inclusivity is a racist crime. Throughout high school, there was an internal need to mimic whiteness. I said I only dated white men. I curated my image to the likeness of my white friends. My Asian history was pared down to a page or two in white textbooks. It feels ironic as I hesitate to write this, concerned with how to make this testimony as palatable as possible.